I'd say it's about bloody time I got around to creating this series, eh? Ever since I teased this as a Patreon goal, like, 2 or so years ago, I had people chomping at the bit for this series. Hell, honestly, it's been way longer than that. Even before the rise and fall of Weezer was finished, one of the first search terms that would auto-populate when searching for the Rock Critic or Rise and Fall was Green Day. No joke, Green Day would always pop up as a search identifier for my channel and the work I did, even before I'd even reviewed or mentioned Green Day in any capacity. I still don't know why that is, actually. Maybe it's just because Green Day is one of the biggest rock acts in current history? Maybe it just felt like a natural progression to go from talking about Weezer to talking about Green Day,
especially given where they were in their career at that time.
But yeah, this series pretty much exists entirely because, from the start, you guys requested it. You were really aching to hear my thoughts on this band. You wanted to hear me break down their history, analyze their discography, and really get into the nitty-gritty on this band that so many of you love so much.
But guys, if I can be 100% honest with you, kinda didn't want to do it?
Ugh, I know how that probably sounds, but, well, my personal relationship to Green Day is a little odd. It's not like Weezer, where they were a band I discovered early, followed their entire career, and whose music is basically a part of my childhood, in the same way whiny people gripe about movie reboots, you know, wah, my childhood, yee.
No, truth be told, I actually didn't get into this band until around, like, 97, maybe 98? Like, my jumping on album was actually Nimrod. See, I didn't really hear a lot of the stuff from Dookie and Insomniac and etc. until much later. The worst part is, I don't even have a good excuse for this. Like, really, my only excuse is, well, I was a big Weezer fan back in the day, and, well,
I asked you to go to the Green Day concert. You said you never heard of them. How cool is that?
Because Weezer specifically told me not to. And you just ruin everything, don't you?
So yeah, there isn't the same affection here that I had for Weezer as a result of me coming in so late. My opinions of this band's work, they're kinda all over the place. Don't get me wrong, I love Green Day, I really do. I wouldn't make a series like this if I didn't, but my opinions on where this band shines, where they fall short.
Look, all I'm saying here is that my personal opinion on this band might vary wildly from yours, or even the Green Day general consensus out there. But that isn't necessarily a bad thing. I mean, I don't expect you all to agree with me, and if you do disagree with me, that doesn't make your opinion invalid or anything, okay? Like I say over and over and over again, the only opinion that really matters is your own, so please just keep that in mind before you head to the comments section on this particular series, okay? Oh, eat shit, fuckbag! Don't be like that guy.
Where the hell was I? Oh, yeah. Well, Green Day was formed in 1986.
Yes, you heard me right. 1986. In the most technical of ways, Green Day is an 80s band. Hell, this band is only 1 year older than me. And I'm old as fuck.
By 14-year-old longtime school buds Billy Joe Armstrong and Michael Ryan Pritchard. They would often spend their days jamming out to stuff like the Ramones, Van Halen, and Operation Ivy, and eventually they got together with their other buddy John Kiffmeyer, also known as Al Sobrante, and formed the group Sweet Children. The band played several local clubs and other small gigs around the San Francisco area, and eventually, in 1988, they caught the attention of Lookout Records, a small local label that released albums from groups like Screeching Weasel, The Queers, and one of Mike and Billy's favorite bands, Operation Ivy. The band signed to Lookout, but decided to change their name to avoid confusion with another local group called Sweet Baby. They decided to name themselves after a song Billy had written called Green Day. Under their new name, the band released a handful of EPs, and by 1990, they released their first full-length album, 39 Smooth.
Though when people often refer to Green Day's first album, chances are they're not referring to 39 Smooth specifically. More than likely, they're talking about this thing, with the exact same cover. 1039 Smoothed Out Slappy Hours. Just rolls right off the tongue, doesn't it? This was a compilation album Lookout released around 1991. It basically just smushes 39 Smooth together with all of the EPs they'd released up to that point. When I refer to Green Day's first album, this is what we're talking about. Is that kind of cheating? Maybe, but people, look, we got a lot of ground to cover, and frankly, this album doesn't give me much to talk about.
I mean, the album isn't abysmal or anything. I've heard worse from this era. I can't live without your love and affection. Man, is this thing rough around the edges. Even for its time, it was fairly slipshod. The production is crazy lo-fi and crazy rough. There's basically no polish here to speak of. And for some bands, yeah, that can be a pretty good thing, especially in the punk scene. I mean, the Queers sound great under these conditions. Operation Ivy sounded great under these conditions. Green Day?
And yeah, look, I don't care how long of a novel you type into the comments, this thing just isn't as good as a lot of the later stuff Green Day would come to put out, you know? Even some of the crappier stuff. It is what it is.
I mean, I can't necessarily fault the band for this. Hey, when you're up and coming, you work with whatever you got, especially back in the old days. And the fact that they were able to get on Operation Ivy's label and even have Jesse Michaels contribute artwork to their album, I'm sure they were happy to just have whatever the hell they could get. But Green Day's more poppy, more live and bouncy sound just benefits greatly from a nice, polished production. Pop music always benefits from clean production, and crystal production would eventually become a staple of the pop-punk sound. It can go too far in the opposite direction.
What was a family is now a shell. We're raising kids now.
But you guys get my general drift here, right? This album's production just kinda kneecaps it.
But even if they'd had Brian Eno or Rick Rubin or Butch Vig, well, not Butch Vig necessarily, but even if this album did have good production, I still don't think it would have ended up terribly well because the band just isn't quite there yet. The production isn't the only sloppy thing here. The band is still really trying to get their footing at this point, and it shows. Billy's playing is sloppy, and he has trouble staying in rhythm, plus his singing is downright amateurish here. He sounds like he hasn't even finished puberty yet, which, I mean, he very well may have not, but still, it's not much fun to listen to today. Mike's line work is also a little clunky and sometimes off-kilter with the rest of the group, and John Kiffmeyer's drums.
Maybe it's not fair to compare at this stage in their career, but yeah, Kiffmeyer is no Trey Cool, and that's one of the biggest drawbacks this album has going against it. Like, Trey isn't even in the band yet, and even though Kiffmeyer isn't the worst in the world, Yeah, I'm glad he didn't stick around. It's almost like with Rush when John Rutsey had to leave the band. I mean, there was nothing inherently wrong with Rutsey, but if Rutsey hadn't made that space available, we never would have gotten Neil Peart. And that would have been the real tragedy here. Although now that I've flat out said it, I'm sure there's gonna be at least one or two people in the comments just going, "How motherfucking dare you? John Rutsey is a national treasure, and I will not have anyone talking shit about him. He was 50 times better than Neil. I'm overrated as all fuck burnt. Is ever gonna be in his career, and is no goddamn fair, because Rutsey is the best drummer that ever was, and you ain't nothing, and you is a dumb shit, and they never play Garden Road anymore! Why don't they ever play Garden Road? Garden Road!"
The album's got some bruises and blisters here and there. I mean, if all you've heard is the main label Green Day stuff, then this is gonna make for a harsh listen. But it's not completely devoid of charm or anything. At the Library has a solid groove, the track from which Green Day got their namesake is a fun little immature romp, and their cover of Operation Ivy's Knowledge is surprisingly solid. I honestly wouldn't think this band would be able to pull off a song like that, but no, it's a must listen. Even if you're a fan, I'd still say approach this one with major caution. But it's an interesting curio, a neat little insight into the band's roots. It's almost kind of hard to believe the heights these guys would rise to, starting from this. This isn't anyone's favorite album, but if you're a Green Day completionist or you're really into lo-fi 90s punk, hey, it's worth hunting down.
Just don't pay too much for it. Are you motherfucking kidding me here?
But the band would move on to bigger things, and after Kiffmeyer left the group in 1990, the band recruited Lookout's drummer Frank Edwin Wright III. And after they were able to get him in the drummer's seat, they followed up 39 Smooth with Kerplunk. Weirdly fitting sound effect for that.
Kerplunk was definitely a step in the right direction. Things are a bit more tight on this album, the band had more time to tour and promote themselves on the East Coast, and they were starting to build up that signature insane Green Day work ethic that would come to produce so many great albums and shows to come. And at the time, it was starting to pay off fairly well too. The band was able to circulate a lot of underground buzz, and they were eventually able to move 50,000 copies of their initial Kerplunk pressing. Not too shabby at all for a bunch of stoned out teenagers from the Bay. Hell, this album, even though it didn't set the world on fire necessarily during its release, once the band broke, it enjoyed a very healthy resurgence, even going on to sell 1 million copies by 2013 and becoming one of the best-selling independent albums of all time. Yeah, people, this thing has gone platinum. I mean, it took its sweet time getting there, but still, you know?
But truth be told, I still don't really care for this album. Yeah, I know. Go ahead, eat me alive, OG Green Day fanbase. I don't like this album that much. It's got problems. God, if you think this opinion sucks, just wait till we get further on in the video. But still, this album just makes for kind of a harsh listen, primarily because it suffers from a lot of the same issues that 1039-smooth-slappy-hours-happy-sweet-children-time... It suffers from a lot of the same problems that Chris did. I'm calling this album Chris from here on in for my own goddamn sanity. I'm sorry, but that title is worse than a Wii U-era Mario game title.
But yeah, there's still some serious issues here. The production is a little better, but it still really doesn't meet the demands of the music they're making. And while Billy and Mike have gotten a bit more proficient behind their instruments, they're still far from perfect. It's a bit sloppy, it's not terrifically executed in places. And Trey? Well, to go back to my Rush comparison, this thing sure as hell ain't Fly By Night.
Blah, 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 the man who hold high places must be the ones who start. Why the fuck don't they play Garden Road? Walking down this garden road! Don't nobody down their music no more! Even Rush don't buckle the band their music no more. You're a fuck.
Trey actually had a lot of trouble gelling with the band at first. His style was way more complicated and all over the place than what the other guys were used to, and they had such a hard time getting used to his beats that it nearly caused a breakup.
Holy shit, can you imagine the bizarro world universe where Green Day quit after Kerplunk? Dodged a bullet there, am I right? Man, talk about squandered potential.
But the guys convinced Trey to cut some of the dead weight from his kit, dial things back with the intensity, and take a more rhythmic, keep it simple, stupid approach to his drumming, and eventually he was able to settle in. As Trey himself put it, he learned to play the song, not the instrument.
But the thing is, on this album, he's not quite there yet. His style is just way too frantic and chaotic and all over the place. Which, on paper, for a punk group, I know that sounds ideal, actually, but, well, you gotta remember, this band is pop punk, and not only are they pop punk, they were pop punk before pop punk even had much of a name or an identity or even much of a title. Like, the trails of pop punk hadn't even been blazed yet. So the band was recording this pop-punk album with the mindset of an early 90s raw punk album. And there's like a stylistic clash that doesn't come over terribly well. It's not a style of drumming that lends well to this specific kind of sound. And again, that's mostly just because the sound was just getting born. This was just being created. This is the birthing period for pop punk, essentially. This is just not an ideal setup for this band. And nowhere is this more apparent than on one of this album's biggest standout tracks, Welcome to Paradise.
Yeah, this might come as a surprise to some of you Green Day noobs, but yeah, the song that would eventually catapult this band into the stratosphere actually got its start here on Kerplunk, and man, it serves as the perfect blueprint for Kerplunk's overall issues. The mixing is all wrong. Billy's just ever so slightly off key with his vocals, Derrick's bass lines aren't quite as bouncy as they need to be, plus all the instruments sound far too muted and fuzzed out, and all the vocals sound like they're being recorded into tin cans. Again, all the problems that haunted Chris are still present here mostly. The production is just doing them no favors. I mean, this sounds more like a demo than a full finalized album track. Especially when compared to what would come.
Again, it's that raw 90s punk mentality at work that doesn't necessarily blend too well into a pop punk motif. I mean, Trey is playing so fast that Billy and Mike can barely keep up. You know, it's a style over substance approach to drumming, which in some scenarios is great, but for a pop punk band like this, it doesn't work. It clashes too much. I mean, any great band is like a basketball team. Yeah, Michael Jordan was a phenomenal player, but without the support of, you know, equally talented guys like Scottie Pippen, Dennis Rodman, Tony Kukoc, Scott Kerr, yeah, Jordan would have got his ass kicked every night. I don't care what Space Jam taught us, it's teamwork that makes the dream work. And the teamwork on this album, it's not quite there yet.
I mean, again, the album isn't unlistenable, far from it. It's got much more sheen and cohesiveness than Chris ever did, and it's another interesting case study into the band's development. It's something a Green Day fan would really get a kick out of, but overall, I'm gonna go against the grain and say this thing does get maybe a bit too much love. It's still very underdeveloped. It's really only something that those already well-educated in Green Day would get that much enjoyment out of. I mean, holy God, if you've never listened to Green Day and decided to start from the very beginning, you are in for a really rough ride. And look, hardcore fans,
boo me all you damn well please, but I'm just talking to the newbies in this instance. I'm looking out for them. Don't start with these two. You know where they'll be found when you can come back around. I mean, yeah, some people have a lot of affection for Kerplunk, and I wouldn't say that's necessarily misplaced or anything. Again, it's got a snotty, lo-fi, early 90s charm to it, but is it, as Blender once put it, one of the greatest indie rock albums of all time, or as Pitchfork put it, a magnitude above its predecessors and only a hair behind the follow-up? Hell no! Fucking hair behind the follow-up? Really, Pitchfork?
I'm sorry, this is a weird aside, but the older I get, the more and more I just hate Pitchfork's reviews. Is that just me?
Pitchfork Media. Everything you love sucks, and we're just better people than you.
It's got its flaws. Many flaws, to be frank, but it's still a step in the right direction. Though I don't think anything would prepare the band, or the rest of the world for that matter, as to what would come next.
Ooh, I think you all know what's coming up next. I mean, do I even have to build this one up?
Yeah, you do. It's your job.
Was that entirely necessary?
I mean, as long as it's taken you to get this series going, I'd say totally so.
Oh, shit.
I mean, it only took me like 2 months to review their entire discography. I mean, dude, freaking get good.
Well, okay, fine.
Well, after Kerplunk's underground success, you better believe the labels came a-courtin', offering the band expensive meals, decadent sums of money, and one promoter going as far as to offer them a trip to Disneyland.
And they turned down everybody. At least that's the legend.
Whoa, wait a minute. They turned down free Disneyland? What kind of American idiot turns down free Disneyland?
I don't know, dude. I mean, I'd probably turn down free Disney if I were in their shoes. I mean, it's just Disneyland. I mean, whatever. It's not that big of a deal. Oh, you know what I wouldn't turn down, though, if they offered? Universal Studios. Holy shit, that place is getting better every day, isn't it? Like, friggin' Wizarding World of Harry Potter, the new Fast and Furious thing, Walking Dead, the new King Kong. King Kong's finally back, that's awesome. The motherfucking Simpsons ride, holy shit. Oh, and Nintendo Land is coming later? Holy god. Oh man, I'm gonna visit Universal Studios and fucking shit in the hallway to Shrek 4D and just have a grand old- Was it something I said?
Yeah, the band pretty much turned down all of the major labels that came to them. Hell, being the snot-nosed little 90s punks they were, of course they did. Hell, the inner sleeve to the original 39 Smooth record apparently even had pictures of a handwritten letter from original drummer John Kiffmeyer telling IRS to fuck off.
You know, IRS. That monolithic megacorporation that was responsible for all this. Look, I'm just saying, you gotta be really dedicated to the underground to tell IRS to fuck off. God. Damn.
The band were doing the legit punk rock thing for ages until they were approached by Rob Cavallo.
Remember this name, you'll be hearing it a lot.
Of Reprise Records. The band had previously heard his work with fellow Californians the Muffs, and he was the only rep that came to them with which they seemed to share any rapport. Eventually, Cavallo convinced the group to sign with Prod and left their previous label Lookout on almost glowing terms, a deal that every band pretty much dreams of, and a decision that ultimately left their fan base pissed beyond belief.
Yeah, remember all that legit punk rock dude shit I mentioned earlier? Yeah, that ended up, coming back around.
Their initial OG California fanbase was absolutely throttled at this decision and started labeling them, sing along if you know the words, sellouts! And it wasn't just your typical pissy fanboys either. 924 Gilman Street, one of the clubs that helped the band launch their initial career, as well as launch several other notable California groups, full-on banned them from the club entirely. This ban stayed in effect until 2015. No fucking joke.
These guys had to make it into the motherfucking Rock and Roll Hall of Fame before their home club would let them perform there again. Jesus. There's being hashtag legit punk, and then there's just being a spiteful asshole. Good God, I'm sorry, but I fucking hate all that sellout shit. It's such petty nonsense. See, this was more of an issue in like the 80s and the 90s, but man, people just screaming sell out because a band signs to a major label or something. It's so petty. It's so stupid and contradictory. Oh, hey, this band I like just signed to a major label and gets to do their work full time and not live off of gas station hot dogs and sleep on the floors of vans. Boo! Sell out! You suffer for my amusement! You suffer because I didn't get to live my broken dreams! You suffer because you're not a legit! Yeah, for God's sake, people, especially those of you that are in bands, like, legit, don't listen to that bullshit! Those people are assholes! If you do happen to get big, they will be the first ones to kiss your ass! The most valuable two words you can learn to people who say that to you are fuck and you.
But after a fairly smooth recording process, and a couple of remixes, the band was finally able to produce Dookie, their long-awaited and, in some circles, full-blown reviled upcoming third album. A lot was on the line here. Like, really, the band was unknown in most circles at that point, and the circles that they had come from had pretty much all but rejected them. This was a real sink or swim moment for the band. Either they nailed it with this album, or they went back to California as punk rock pariahs and full-blown failures. So how did it do?
God fucking damn!
This album fucking exploded! Granted, its first week was a little sluggish, but once word got around, holy hell, this thing was a spark that started a damn forest fire. And before you could say masturbation's lost its fun, Dookie was on everyone's radios, everyone's TVs, and in everyone's ears. And that is precisely how you get an infection, ew.
The problem was I had my finger in my ear because I had an ear infection.
I'm so glad you stopped doing that, yeah, because that's why it got infected. You kept putting your finger in there.
And then my
you
finger got infected.
You've got to wash it before you put it in your ear. Yeah.
Dookie dropped to almost universal positive reviews. It charted in 7 different countries, including peaking at number 2 in the U.S., has hit either platinum or gold certification in 14 other countries, and has even been named the best album of 1994 by Rolling Stone. Both the readers and the staff. Now seriously, how often does that happen? Hell, even the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame themselves placed this album at number 50 on their definitive 200 list.
Definitive, mind. Note that word, definitive. This album was so successful, it literally helps define rock and roll.
The album would go on to be nominated for 4 Grammys, and it even won Best Alternative Music Performance. Hell, eventually this album got so big that, to this day, it's become one of the only punk rock albums, unless you get really broad with the definition and include acts like Nirvana, Beastie Boys are no doubt in there, it became one of the only punk rock albums to get Diamond certification.
And that's only a drop in the bucket of the accolades this album would receive over time.
It's baffling to think about how successful this album got. This was one of the records of the 90s that changed everything. This was what got the ball rolling. Green Day by no means invented pop punk. Hell, if you ask them personally, they'd probably just say they were trying to rip off all of the people that they listened to as kids. But they were the guys able to make pop punk a household name. Before Green Day, there wasn't even really a term for this super high energy guitar rock that had snarling, chaotic composition and demeanor, but also the kind of radio-friendly hooks and melodies that would make people beg to hear it on the radio. These guys were the forebears and godfathers of pop punk. So, after 23 years of acclaim, constant radio play, and award after award after award, how does this album hold up today?
Eh, it's a wee bit dated, if I'm being perfectly honest. Holy shit. Mr. D.Va, status report.
Captain, we're being assaulted by all the negative comments. The people, Captain, they're upset that you didn't build dookie and slobbery timepieces, and now they're flooding the comments with icky purple bullshit.
Are you trying to do a Scottish accent?
Hey, look, English is weird enough without all those stupid accents and dialects and all this bullshit. I'm doing the best I can.
No, I'm not hating. It's fucking adorable.
I wish your audience would just learn Korean. Korean, my mom, I'll teach you that. And then together.
Divert power from the main engines and focus on the troll repellers and shitposting phasers.
But Captain, I don't have the power.
That's an order, Mr. D.Va. In the meantime, I'll see what I can do to steer us out of this mess. Guys, let me explain.
Yes, this album is stellar, but man, it is a product of its time. The album came out in February of 1994. No less than 2 months later, Kurt Cobain would commit suicide. Basically,
without going into an overly complicated spiel about it,
killing off the grunge era. This really brought people down. I mean, Nirvana was the biggest, most influential modern band in the world. And suddenly, just like that, they were over. I dare say, to rockers at least of a certain age,
you know, old, like me.
This was our day the music died, and people needed something to fill that void. After Kurt died, the bleak, sorrowful, depressing vibe of grunge just felt too real, you know? It hit way too close to home. It's all fun and games until someone actually gets hurt, you know? People were looking for something to fill that ugly little void that grunge just was not gonna settle for anymore. Something that was rocky, but perhaps a bit more joyous, a bit more giddy and carefree. You know, something with a bit of joie de vivre or carelessness and even mischief peppered in there. And I think after Cobain died, Green Day was where a lot of people found what they were looking for to help snap them out of the funk.
It's more or less like pretty much every great rock star success story. Right place, right time.
Green Day was bold, ferocious, and loud, but they were also doofy, childlike, immature, but in a charming Dennis the Menace kind of way, not a shitty 14-year-old shitposter way. Their songs were delicately composed in the rhythm, but almost comically simple in the basic melody and guitar structures, making them the perfect band to inspire people to pick up their own guitars and actually learn how to play them.
I'm serious, to this day, Green Day's stuff, especially the stuff from their back catalog, is a perfect tool for beginners and newbies who are just learning their instruments, especially the guitar. Hell, I remember back in the day, I was able to learn more or less the entirety of Nimrod over, like, a weekend. And pursuing that, and actually going through and learning how to play those songs, was what sparked and helped keep my interest in becoming a musician and learning how music worked. And the kicker of Green Day's catalog is, once you've learned all these guitar parts, you can revisit these songs once you pick up a bass or a drum kit, and all of a sudden, you're playing the exact same material on expert mode. Hell yeah! Dude, it's like Dark Souls. It's more challenging, but the deeper you dig into it, the more you really grow to love it and appreciate what it's doing to you. It makes you a better musician. Learning Green Day music helps make you become a better musician. I can't scientifically prove that, but I will sure as fuck stand by it.
Just take the album's debut single, Longview. The song is absolutely carried by Dearent's stellar bass line, a line he wrote while blitzkrieged on LSD, by the way. Fun fact, this line is only a partial recreation of what Mike had written. He had completely forgotten the rest. It really makes me wonder what could have been here, you know, if he'd been able to remember the whole thing. But man, this line is just deliciously all over the place. It jumps all the way across the fretboard, playing with various scales, and it just helps hammer home the song's theme of ennui, boredom, and dissatisfaction.
It's something that's gloriously complex and interesting and creative, if you're paying attention to it. But even if not, whatever, it's a kick-ass song about weed and jerking off. Kick it!
That's the way the rest of the album is too. Check out When I Come Around. The guitar part is a bit more complex, but we almost never move away from a basic power chord structure. It's still pretty damn easy, but Dearent is flying all over the bass, and Trey is propping up the song with diverse and interesting tom placement. Basket Case is the same way. Hell, Billy is carrying most of the opening on his own, but once the bass and drums kick in, oh my God, that's when the song really comes alive. There's so much to love, and even on the few songs where things are left pretty straightforward and simple, you know, stuff like the opener, Burnout, for example, they still find ways to impress you. I mean, just listen to Trey on those bridge breakdowns.
See, you listen to this exact moment on Dookie, and it's when you realize Trey's finally got his groove.
But please don't think I'm underselling Billy here just because his guitar work isn't all that difficult. I mean, I guess I kind of am, but believe me, A, it works, so who the hell gives a shit, and B, Billy makes up for that in many other ways. His songwriting, for example, is terrific.
See, Billy penned pretty much every song on this album. Well, except for All By Myself, but,
I went in your room. I was all by myself.
Yeah, we don't necessarily count that one. But the thing is, Billy's doing a pretty good job of mixing things up and making things a bit more interesting than they really have to be.
I mean, when people think of early Green Day, especially during this time, they thought snotty, immature, not very deep or insightful, just something straight out of the teenage boy's guidebook to being an asshole. Which, well, yeah, there is plenty of that in there. I mean, Longview is literally like 70% of the people I knew in high school. Chump is pretty much the anthem of every girl who dumped your sorry ass in high school. And All By Myself?
All By Myself.
Well, yeah, this is a thing, even if it was a hidden track.
Oh man, I miss hidden tracks. Like, is that something you younger viewers even know about? It was complicated how that worked, CDs and such. I sound so fucking old right now.
But when Billy really wanted to, he could tug at your heartstrings, even if only for just a minute or two. The loneliness and fear that comes off in Welcome to Paradise certainly raises a few hairs on the back of my neck, especially towards the end of the song when the protagonist finds out that, yeah, he can make it on his own. And the honesty and dread of coming clean, a song about Billy Joe opening up about his sexuality, and Basket Case in particular.
Well, speaking as someone who actually does suffer from chronic anxiety, yeah, you better believe this song rings pretty true to me. It's a weirdly brutal and just blunt look at what it's like to suffer from this condition, you know? I mean, there are times where if you suffer from anxiety, yeah, you do kind of give yourself the creeps and you weird yourself out and, you know, your mind does play tricks on you sometimes. And, like, it's a weird window into the just chronic panic. The relentless feeling of dread that always kind of sneaks up on you and won't leave you alone throughout your day. And it affects the way you operate, and it affects your connections to other people. I'd say this is a song that really applies to me. Like, it speaks to me.
How about the part about hiring male prostitutes? Is that part one true too?
D.Va! Get back to focusing on those phasers.
This album is a triumph, an absolute watershed moment, not only in punk, but in music history. This album is one of the few records out there that gets all the goddamn dick-sucking hype in the world. But yeah, it totally deserves every ounce of it.
But that doesn't mean this album isn't dated as all fuck. I mean, this thing is a 90s album through and through. It's 90s with a capital 9. It's an episode of Saved by the Bell eating Dunkaroos and drinking Capri Sun while being blown by Belle Biv DeVoe while watching the O.J. Simpson trial. This is a dirty little time capsule into just what we were doing back then, you know?
No, really, I mean, the slavish devotion to power chords, the juvenile, bratty attitude, the fuck authority mentality that wasn't so much a rise up in the streets, but more of a pull the principal's pants down during assembly kind of mentality. I mean, listen to Billy's vocal delivery.
Am I just paranoid? Mispronouncing the fuck out of words wasn't just something Cobain did. Only in the 90s could ay-ay-ay-ay mean something. Cheers. This shit is terrible. Why did our parents let us drink this?
Dookie is one of those albums that you'll love, but when you listen to it, you know exactly where it came from. And even though it is what it is, that isn't necessarily a bad thing. It's a product of its time. I mean, Purple Rain is easily one of the best albums ever made, but
yeah, this comes from the 80s, no doubt.
And this thing is just a testament to the good shit that the 90s was able to produce. Hell, this album was so revolutionary, you could damn well say it's the reason why the 90s sounded like they did. And hell, even the future slate of modern music? Just look at all these albums that wouldn't have even been without Dookie's influence. Like, to say this album is a masterpiece is to undersell it. It's a product of its time, sure, but in the exact best possible way. This album isn't just a product of its time, this album is its time.
Which makes it difficult when talking about Insomniac, really, because, yeah, they weren't able to live up to those expectations. Oh, for God's sake. Mr. D.Va, status report! Mr. D.Va?
Stop calling me Mr. I'm a lady.
Excuse me, Ms. D.Va, status report.
Now it's the Insomniac Defenders, Captain. They're rubbing bodies at their vessel. I don't know how much more she can take.
Don't worry, I can steer us out of this one. Just focus on repelling the piss babies and man children. I'll have us out of this in no time.
You're damn well better, you stupid dickhead.
Well, that's no way to speak to your captain.
You know, I'm the only one here who has experience in frying and operating high-tech machinery. Why the hell do you get to be the captain?
Gotta go. Yeah, let me get into that.
Insomniac had a damn hell of an uphill battle to fight. Maybe one of the biggest uphill battles in punk history. I mean, when your last album completely restructures the face of modern American music, how do you follow that up? Well, the following year, the band got back together with Rob Cavallo and crafted their answer, which was kinda just do the same thing over again. Only this time more edgy, more loud, more angry, blah! This album has a surprising amount of anger on it, like a lot, in both the playing and the lyrics. A lot of this album was created as kind of a response to all the people that called them sellouts and abandoned them right before Dookie dropped. I mean, the album Oper, Armitage Shanks, basically sets up the more nihilistic, angry tone. 86 is basically about how harshly the Gilman Band pissed these guys off, and their exquisite closer, Walking Contradiction.
I'm sorry, but this song may as well be titled Comment Section. Look, some of you are doing it. Some of you are doing it right fucking now, aren't you? Some of you are completely in that comment section. Not a modicum of self-awareness.
Brand another goddamn thing. Let me tell you about why you're wrong about motherfucking Foghat. Foghat is Lord. Foghat is the best thing ever was. Some bullshit motherfucking Neil Peart ass. Bullshit ass. Fucking working man ass. I can't feel feelings in my heart.
Even the instrumentation is a lot more straightforward and gut-punching. It just screams of frustration and disillusionment. Chord structures are choppier, the drums are much more blast-focused than melody-driven. It almost feels like there are spaces in between all of the songs where the only purpose there is to lift a middle finger to all the haters. But again, don't misread me here. It isn't bad. Far from it. Insomniac is quite the enjoyable listen if you're willing to settle into its unique groove. All the stellar instrumentation hasn't gone anywhere. The feelings of anger and feeling cheated, well, they certainly weren't invalid, and they certainly don't come off as disingenuous. Hell, if anything, this album feels a bit more mature than Dookie did. In some respects, at least. But... well, that's kind of the problem, isn't it? Dookie. See, this album has to stand next to Dookie, and it kinda can't compare. While it does do some things to differentiate itself from that album, it doesn't do quite enough. Honestly, the style is a bit louder and edgier, almost metallic in places, but it still sounds just too close to Dookie to really get a good feel for it.
And see, that's this album's overall issue. It does do some things to set itself apart from Dookie, but not really enough. I mean, it still sounds kind of reminiscent of Dookie. It's more like a Dookie B-sides compilation or a Dookie follow-up than its own distinct thing. But I don't necessarily blame the band for taking this direction. Not at all, really. I mean, if you were Billy Joe Armstrong, would you have wanted to mess with the formula too much? I mean, really. I mean, most bands, when their first album breaks this big, don't even tend to stray as far as Insomniac strayed from Dookie. So you gotta give props there, but at the same time, the album just feels like more Dookie without necessarily being more Dookie, which, makes it kind of a walking contradiction.
But again, it isn't bad. It's got plenty of standout tracks. Armitage Shanks, Geek Stink Breath, Babs Uvula Who, Brain Stew, Jaded, Walking Contradiction. Dear God, do I love Walking Contradiction. All are exquisite tracks that, even if they don't necessarily innovate all that much, they still show us that the band had plenty of chutzpah, energy, and creativity to spare. The album just feels a little saggy in places, mostly because, well, we heard them do better before. And you know what, yeah, maybe it isn't fair to compare this album to Dookie so much, but when it sounds so similar to Dookie, you know, what else am I gonna do? I mean, if Dookie was an A+, then this album is still a solid B+, maybe even an A-. Even if it looks like the band tried to turn in the same paper twice. But that just kind of speaks to the testament of just how good the first paper was. If this album has a major failing, it's really just that it's not as good as Dookie. And again, how the hell was it supposed to be?
But at this point, people were already wondering if maybe Green Day was going to be the next big thing. I mean, Insomniac still sold and performed fairly well, and critics were still nice to it, but not as nice as they were with Dookie. It still did disappoint, all things considered. Yeah, I realize, how is it supposed to do better? But, I mean, still, it is what it is. The album sold a bit less, and it reviewed a bit worse, so people were just starting to wonder if maybe that was the only string to their bow, you know? They needed to rise above. They needed to mix things up on their next album. They needed to show us that they were more than just, you know, power chords and stoner humor. They needed to progress a wee bit.
But the band were fully aware of this going into 1995. Their insanely rapid rise from Cali club band to sports arena filling Golden Boys was starting to take its toll, so they canceled the European leg of the Insomniac tour, sorry Great Britain, we'll make it up to you, and focused on getting a bit of rest.
Not something this band does terribly often, as you'll see as we progress in this series.
During this time, though, the guys were still writing and rehearsing when they could, and by 1997, they had enough material to hit the studio again. Even though the last album wasn't quite as successful, the guys still chose to go with Rob Cavallo as producer. Again, he seemed to bring out the best in this band. Usually.
I know I keep bringing it up, and it probably sounds weird now, but trust me, this will mean something as we go further along in the series.
Out of a total of around 30 songs written, the guys took the best 18, collected them together, and brought us Nimrod.
And to the people who said this band was homogenous or they only had one trick up their sleeve, this album did help shut some of those voices up.
This album is kinda all over the place. There's plenty of good old-fashioned pop punk like Nice Guys Finish Last, Jinx, and Take Back, but there's also a ton of goofing around with other genres, too. Hell, the first single, Hitchin' a Ride, sounds like something the Stray Cats would have put out if they'd done way more cocaine back in the day.
In fact, I actually remember hearing a lot of people say, "Man, the new Green Day song is weird, it doesn't sound like them anymore." And that was ultimately what sparked my interest. It's what got me listening to the band. By 1997, I had finally gotten the common sense to tell Rivers to fuck off. Never again. And I figured, great, what better time than now to check them out?
And yes, like I mentioned previously, this album was my jumping on point. And, you know, yeah, everyone and their brother told me I should have started way back with Dookie, and they were right. They were right. You were all right, okay? I admit it. You won. You take that victory. But look, this album, I was just blown away by everything they were doing. The gorgeously layered guitar work and classic rock structure of Redundant, the horns and ska-style swing of King for a Day, the straight-up alt-rock, almost Foo Fighters right hook of Hoshenka, and even the wicked style and mellowed-out surf groove of the instrumental Last Ride In. It was a goddamn trip.
This is a punk album that experiments and mixes things up, but never really loses its intensity. I mean, songs like The Grouch, Platypus, and Reject keep that momentum going, even when we deviate from the formula and, you know, mix things up a little bit. It's an album that, even when it spins off into weird new directions, you never forget that it's a punk album at its core. Even when that penultimate track comes up, you never forget that this is a punk album. And you people know exactly what track I'm talking about at this point. Fuck.
Yep, you knew we had to get to this one eventually. Good Riddance, Time of Your Life. This is arguably one of the biggest songs Green Day would ever release. Even if you've never heard of this band, I promise you, you've probably heard this song at least 100 times in other places. It's been used on countless TV shows, movies, sporting events, etc., etc. The song has become a graduation slash high school prom staple too, so maybe you heard it there. And you know, it kinda makes perfect sense for that to be too. I mean, the song is about a breakup, the same breakup that form the basis for songs like She, What's Her Name, and Amanda.
God damn, lady, whatever you did to Billy Joe, it must have been brutal because it's been influencing the entire goddamn world of music for the last 20 years now. I mean, I hope he's at least splitting the royalties with you.
But its slow, tender melody and thoughtful, introspective lyrical content is grossly different from the usual Green Day formula. Hell, I think the last time these guys touched an acoustic guitar for an album track, it was All By Myself. but I'll be damned if this didn't work out exceptionally well. Billy was initially scared shitless to share this song with the band. He wrote it in 1990, but didn't even make it known until 1993. There was an attempt to get it recorded for Dookie, but yeah, that was pretty quickly shot down. But given that this album had more of an anything and everything approach, they figured, yeah, you know, what the hell, we'll throw it on there. And for as good as this song is, it isn't even really anyone in Green Day that really lands the killing blow of this song. Hear me out. They almost considered scrapping this track again after Rob Cavallo noticed that it just wasn't working, no matter what they tried. But he got a spark of an idea, and he sent the rest of the guys out of the studio for about 15 and 20 minutes to just play some foosball and dick around. And when they came back, Cavallo had added this to the song.
Those strings, those goddamn strings, people. Like, my God, they're so light and airy and playful. They help build the mood. They create the atmosphere to help sell this song as a monument to moving on, to progressing, to getting on with your life. That's why it sounds like it works as a graduation song. And the thing is, these strings took 15 minutes to record. 15 minutes! Guys, this goes to prove two big things. One, yes, your producer matters, make sure you hire a good one. And two, never underestimate the power of 15 minutes and a good idea.
I mean, this song was played everywhere all throughout the 90s and pretty well into the 2000s too. Oh, from what I understand, there are still high school classes that use this song as a graduation tune. I mean, it beats the hell out of fucking Photograph, but you know. This song has almost become kind of infamous for those reasons. It got way overplayed. I swear I heard this song on the radio every 20 goddamn minutes in high school and college, but you know, that isn't the band's fault. It's just that awesome of a tune. It's a beautifully simplistic and gorgeous melody with relatable lyrics that nearly anyone can identify with. Of course, people are gonna ask to hear that en masse. And this was the song that ultimately proved, once and for all, that Green Day had crossover potential. They weren't just bratty, immature punk geeks. They had the potential to write astounding music outside the realms of their genre and had only just begun to impress us.
Or at least that's what people should have been saying, but weren't.
Granted, several people were saying that mind, but there were plenty of holdouts that really were not open-minded about this band at all. NME penned a review that basically said the experimentation came simply out of a lack of ideas, and that the band's time was ticking as a result. Seriously, Stuart Bailey, how do you feel about that last sentence today, homeboy? Just randomly curious. Spin was more generous numerically, but the review reads like he just listened to the band's demise. Oh, come on, dude. In 1997, it was way too soon to be using that phrase.
Like, I don't know, maybe this is the pot calling the kettle black, being a critic and all, but guys, if you get the time, go back to, like, classic album reviews and read the bad ones. Like, ugh. God, it's some of the best comedy you can find. Ugh. But in addition to the critical backlash, there was a fair amount of fan backlash, too. This thing wasn't universally praised or loved, even by the fan base. I mean, remember back when I said I heard about this album because all my friends were talking smack about it? Well...
Yeah, this was totally a thing. All the same people who griped and groaned that Insomniac was too samey.
Didn't you do that a second ago?
Shut up.
We're now all complaining that this album was too different. All the people who wanted Green Day to stop being so bratty and immature got their panties in a huff because...
Oh, Green Day's trying to be all mature now? Fuck them, I'm done with that shit. Pass me to Chumbawamba. See, this is the stuff that's gonna last forever, man. This is never gonna go out of style.
Green Day basically did all the stuff that people were asking them to do, and they still got a mouthful of shit for it. Again, many people did like this one, but there was a vocal minority that did not appreciate this bolder new direction.
And if those people didn't care for the new, experimental, more ranged variety of Green Day sound, whoa, boy, you should have seen those people when the next album dropped. Oh, God!
Despite some of the lesser grumblings, Nimrod was still very successful, and the band had a smaller, more purposely intimate tour to help promote it. The band also took a fair amount of time in the recording studio for this one, too. There was a 3-year gap between this particular album, and the band spent the better part of 2 years just rehearsing and writing material for it. In 2000, they entered the studio again, this time without Cavallo. At first, the band just wanted to try out someone new to help continue mixing up their sound, so they brought in Scott Litt, a producer who had worked on Nirvana's In Utero, as well as some of REM's bigger albums.
You gotta love the irony here.
But the chemistry with Litt wasn't exactly lit.
This is what gets me the big YouTube books.
And musical disagreements led them to eventually bring Cavallo back in, but only in a minor supporting role. At this point, the band just said, fuck it, let's do it ourselves. So the album is technically self-produced. That can be a good thing, or a bad thing. No, it hasn't grown on me, I still don't like it. But, well, how did this turn out for Green Day?
Well, without hyperbole or sarcasm or anything like that, I'm totally comfortable in saying that this album is my absolute personal favorite.
Really, dude? Really?
What? What's wrong with that?
Oh, shit!
Yeah, see that right there? That's exactly what I knew was gonna happen. You're supposed to hate this album!
But what? Why?
I don't know, but internet arenas get all huffy and mad when people say good things about Warning. Now you got all this shit to deal with. You know what? I'm done.
Oh, D.Va, come on.
No, I got better things to do. I got prices to fry for it and people to see.
Oh, D.Va, come on now.
You're on your own, honey.
Fuck what anyone says. This album is fucking genius.
Yeah, this one got a lot of flack from the Green Day community. I mean, remember when I said earlier that a certain section of the fanbase got really huffy after Nimrod's more experimental style? Well, that rage got kicked into overdrive on this release, because they took things even further. This album is coated with acoustic guitar work, and a number of more folky, more introspective, and even more socially conscious songs. The album goes in a lot of different directions that people were not used to hearing this band go in. Billy cited Bob Dylan's Bringing It All Back Home as a major inspiration for this album, and guys, believe me, it shows. I mean, that album pissed everyone off too, so there you go.
Like, the elite punk rock fanboys, even more so than usual, were livid.
Green Day's not supposed to use acoustic guitars! Green Day's not supposed to write songs about feelings and emotions and serious issues! Where are my songs about smoking porn and reading pot? 2 out of 10!
But guys, you have to remember where I specifically am coming from on this album. Like, I jumped on in Nimrod, and you know, like, all that experimentation, all that playing around with the punk rock formula, it's actually what got me interested in this band. It's what I liked most about them. I mean, when I did go back to listen to their previous catalog, I actually had a little bit of trouble getting into it initially because it was so doofy and kind of samey sounding at points. But, you know, that experimentation was what I loved about the band. And the fact that they kicked it up to 11 on this release, yeah, you better believe I was all about that. I'm still all about that. This album kicks ass.
Take the title track, for example. Those syncopated acoustic parts. The way Billy strums along, almost like he's playing a rhythm instrument. It's herky-jerky and wonderfully chaotic, and the bass line here is just walking us all the way across the song. Basically, on this track, the guitar and bass full-blown switch roles as far as melody is concerned. The guitar is the support, while the bass takes the forefront. And oh god, that line!
Oh god, it's such a nimble and playful riff. It just walks all the way across the fretboard. It's wonderful. Like, this bass riff is just the thing of magic. Even if, I mean, yeah, it's pretty close, even I gotta admit, but I don't know, I'm still glad the Kinks didn't choose to lawyer up on this one. It still makes for a great song.
You've got stuff like Blood, Sex, and Booze that almost has a bluesy feel to it, with its laid-back verse grooves and explosive chorus. It's like if the Blues Brothers wrote a song about S&M. It's fucking brilliant. There's the doo-woppy kind of 50s swing of Church on Sunday, and Misery?
Weird shit.
Like, it's got a weird gothic carnival sound to it. It almost sounds like it was gonna be a track on the Nightmare Before Christmas OST. It's weirdly spooky, but like comical and fun at the same time.
Holy shit, this was My Chemical Romance 2 years before My Chemical Romance was even a thing.
Like, god damn is it weird hearing songs like this on your typical Green Day album, but this isn't your typical Green Day album. It's got all kinds of strings, acoustics, harmonicas, organs. It's all over the damn map. But, you know, that's what makes me love it so goddamn much. Hold On is practically an early 60s Beatles song. Deadbeat Holiday is like an older track from Kerplunk if it were hammered out by Elvis Costello. And Castaway?
It's like Jet, if Jet didn't suck.
Every track feels like an attempt to try something new, something different. Every song on this album sounds like it could have been the general sound of an entirely different album, which makes perfect sense because that's specifically how the album was written. Every song was written as a risk, as a new creative endeavor, as a stab in a new direction, and a breaking into new musical territory.
And that is baller as fuck! Like, it's so great! It's something straight out of the Frank Zappa or Radiohead playbook. It shows us that the band has the capability to expand beyond their horizons. And it shows us that this whole experimentation, this ability to dip into other pools and try out new things, isn't just a goof or a fluke. This is something the band can do full time and pull it off effectively. This was the album that elevated Green Day beyond snotty jerkwads who wrote songs about jacking off. It showed us that they could do more than that. And God, no more is that more apparent on the closing three tracks. Oh dear God.
Let's start with Waiting. God damn, is this a sunny track? Like, almost too sunny. It's practically bursting sunshine out of its ass, it's so sunny. It literally has the refrain, "Better thank your lucky stars." The song is so optimistic, it's almost sugar-coated. Coming from the guys who wrote Having a Blast and Burnout, you'd think happiness and optimism wouldn't look good on them, or that it would at least be an uncomfortable fit, but nah, dude, they pull this shit off like it's second nature. This song really has a classic 60s pop feel to it. It's a lot like Petula Clark's bigger stuff. You know, Don't Sleep in the Subway or Downtown, or maybe even the sunnier Mamas and the Papas tracks. Again, not a well you'd think these guys would draw from, or at least draw from so effectively, but god damn it if they don't nail the tone. I mean, the song doesn't even really have much of a chorus, but it's still insanely infectious and easy as hell to sing along to. It's just a gloriously written piece of pop music. The same could be said of Macy's Day Parade. Holy shit, This song is almost as slow and subdued as Good Riddance, hell, maybe even more so. I mean, that acoustic guitar-driven melody, those hauntingly gorgeous synths in the background.
And look, for those of you that think I'm going a little overboard with all this exaltation and, oh my god, no way, why did he do that? Guys, you gotta remember, back in these days, this wasn't something we saw with a lot of punk bands. You never saw The Offspring bring in a string section. You never really heard chimes on a Rancid track. Like, this was new and bold and, you know, this was different. We didn't hear a lot of this back then.
It's a gorgeous and touchingly sad melody that closes out the album with a weird, wistful somberness. It's a song about tragedy, a song about having a great big hole in you that material things and societal status will never truly fill. It's weirdly political, but also touching and from the heart. Warning was the same way lyrically. It talks about blindly following leadership and the danger of failing to question the circumstances that surround your everyday decisions, but it's all told through something as simple as warning labels from cough syrup.
Green Day, they weren't a band you really listened to for their message. They weren't a band that you could think of for writing songs that were deep or meaningful or emotional, you know? Like that whole bratty teenager motif. They had a really hard time shaking that off. And this was the album that made us realize that they could, that made us realize that they were deeper than that. And it brings us into, man, what has to be at least my personal favorite Green Day song of all damn time. This is literally right at the tippy top of my list. This is my number one Green Day song ever written. Well, truth be told, it's actually a tie between this and one other one, but we're not quite there yet, so I'll let you know.
Minority. Christ in a Taco Truck, Minority. This song is perfection. From start to finish, this song is just Green Day at their absolute most. They're most ferocious, they're most forceful, they're most melodious, they're most pleasant, they're most engaging, creative, bombastic, and just... Yeah, I adore everything about this song.
Now be sure to leave in the comments why it's the worst song they ever wrote.
But guys, the song is... The song is...
This song is my happy song. Like, legit, I can pop this song in whenever I'm angry or sad or just whatever. I can pop this song in and suddenly just feel fucking better. It's just fucking medicine to me. I love this song. It's so good. It makes me feel better. It makes me feel like the world isn't such a fuck-awful, goddamn miserable place. Which is weird, because it's a song about the world being a fuck-awful, goddamn miserable place.
See, this song was written in 2000 during the absolute madness that was the 2000 election cycle. God, weren't those the days. Billy saw what was going on in George W.'s rise to power, and it really freaked him the fuck out.
He was right, too! Holy shit! Remember how that turned out?
This song was basically written as a great big fuck you to hardline conservatism. And look, before you jump on my ass, Billy's a pretty liberal guy, okay? There's an inverted Pledge of Allegiance.
A pledge, allegiance to the underworld. One nation under dark, there of which I stand alone.
A calling for black sheeps to step out of the herd.
Stepped out of the line, like a sheep runs from the herd.
Even a full-blown middle finger straight in the face of the moral majority.
Down with the moral majority, cause I wanna be the majority.
I mean, technically the moral majority was dissolved long before this point, but whatever, the point still rang true. This dickhead was a dickhead, and so were all the other dickheads that were dickheads like him. Fuck this guy.
And guys, I was in high school when this song came out, and I mean, not to sound like the most unoriginal motherfucker in the world, but yeah, high school was a drag for me. Especially going to a Christian high school that was well, more like a youth group on steroids than an actual legit high school. I mean, I went to this school and I didn't learn shit. I didn't really get along with a lot of the other kids and, you know, given some of the stuff they would say, I wasn't even sure I wanted to get along with a lot of the other kids. I mean, all this talk about, you know, how it was immoral to be another religion and how sex before marriage is a cruel, cruel sin and how, you know, homosexuals are just confused and we need to cure them with Jesus and, you know, all this talk that I just, even back then, I didn't identify with it, you know? I didn't feel like I was a part of this crowd. I didn't feel like that was the way the world worked, or at least not the way it should work, you know? And, you know, being a super shy, super spastic, anxiety-riddled little ball of confusion out in the middle of nowhere but fuck Indiana with no transportation and no internet at that time and no friends to, you know, no friends that I could earnestly, honestly, wholeheartedly speak my mind and my feelings to. I mean, yeah, there were times where I felt just completely fucking alone in the world, you know? But man, when I heard this song, when I heard, you know, Billy Joe singing all those words, all those thoughts and feelings that I was experiencing but didn't even have a complete grasp on, didn't even have the words to make out yet. You know, when I heard Billy Joe sing those things that rang so goddamn true to me, like, God, it became a personal anthem, you know? Like, it spoke to me. I mean, yeah, maybe it's weird saying that about a song that's, you know, kinda goofy and kinda tongue-in-cheeky and has a verse in it about one nation under dog, but, you know, God, I felt like I was a part of that nation, you know? When he sang that line, I just wanted to raise that flag, you know? Hell yeah, I'm one nation under dog. I am a proud member of this nation. I'm a card-carrying citizen. If Billy Joe Armstrong can sing about this, then hell yeah! There's a whole nation of us underdog. Like, raise that flag. We are the faces in the crowd, the songs against the mole. Without a doubt, singled out the only way we know. We are the minority. We are that one nation underdog. I may be taking this a little too far.
I didn't know Green Day, fucking Green Day of all bands, would be able to establish this kind of connection, or write something so goddamn poignant and thoughtful, but they did. They proved themselves to be more than just your dopey friend who ripped killer bong hits and kicked your ass in Mutant League hockey. They proved that they could grow up, that they could be adults, that they could write lyrics and songs with the big boys. And they did it all with a song that's bouncy and tight and with a downright explosive chorus and an anthemic tone. This was the song that proved, to me at least, that A, Green Day were a legitimate band to be reckoned with, and B, that this was only the tip of the iceberg. These guys had potential. These guys weren't just gonna be big for their time. They hadn't even unleashed their full potential yet. They were gonna do something huge. They had yet to begin to even wow us.
But you wouldn't have known that from most of the reviews this thing got. Wow, did people hate this one.
It wasn't necessarily all doom and gloom. The Village Voice were pretty kind to the album. All Music gave them a pretty pleasant write-up. But most of the other critics... Whoa! Yeesh! I mean, hell, just look at this quote from Greg Kot of Rolling Stone. Rolling Stone always loved the shit out of these guys, even from the early days. They were surprisingly hostile towards this album. I quote, "Who wants to listen to songs of faith, hope, and social commentary from what used to be Snotcore's biggest selling band?"
Oh, I don't have a comment or anything here. I just want you to take that in, you know? Just look at that. Read every word succinctly. Get to know that quote. Holy shit, I want this motherfucking quote framed and hung on my wall. Just I mean, to those of you that know what's coming, I... Damn, y'all. Goddamn.
This wasn't just the critics either. People did not generally like this album. Again, a lot of that was for the same reasons that people didn't like Nimrod, only, well, to the nth degree. Weirdos like me really loved the experimentation, but most people were just expecting another Dookie.
Green Day already gave you another Dookie! How many Dookies are you people gonna ask for?
I make fun of that social commentary snotcore comment, but really, a lot of people did genuinely feel that way back in the day. Remember when I said it was hard for this band to shake off their bratty teenage labeling? Well, most people weren't impressed by this. The more folksy, earthy sound, the lack of more traditional punk rock bravado, the acoustic guitars. Oh, the acoustic guitars all over the place. Never has a greater sin been committed. Oh, dear Christ. For most people, this album was a really harsh adjustment. They just weren't feeling it. And unfortunately, sales kind of reflected that attitude. This album sold about half what Insomniac and Nimrod pulled. It was only able to crack gold in its first year and wasn't even able to eke out a platinum certification until 2012. Yeesh, considering the numbers that Dookie pulled off just 6 years prior, that had to be frustrating for the band, if not downright scary.
And some people are still really harsh to this album, even today, and guys, it so doesn't deserve it. It's kind of, I don't want to say undiscovered gem. I mean, how do you have an undiscovered gem from one of the greatest, most popular bands that ever existed? But guys, this album gets a lot of hate that it doesn't deserve. This is one of those albums like One Hot Minute or Zooropa that a lot of people have probably told you sucks, but my God, it does not. Give it us another chance. Like, seriously. Like, if this entire episode has done nothing else but convince you to go out and give Warning another try, then, you know, I'm happy. I can live with that. Because this album, God, it's great. I could do probably a full-length episode on this, but, we probably shouldn't. How long are we into this video? God damn! But, well, the disappointing performance of this album put Green Day in an interesting situation. A situation a lot of bands tend to find themselves at after an album flops. And it was one the band really probably had a hard time wrestling through. Because, you know, they were finally starting to grow. They were finally starting to mature. But people were rejecting it. They didn't want that, or at least that's what it seemed. Like, they were faced with a difficult decision. Do we continue to be bold and take risks and grow and develop and be the band that we want to be? Or do we want to play it safe and scale things back and do something that's just more radio-friendly or more just, you know, more just what the crowd wants to hear from us? What do? Do we take that risk and, you know, 2112 it and just forge the fuck ahead, or do we play it safe? What did Green Day end up doing? Well, I think a lot of you probably know by this point, but for those of you that don't, I won't spoil the surprise. I'll just say, guys, thank you very much for watching this, and like I always say, remember, the only opinion that really matters is your own. Cheers.
Hey, stupid. I almost forgot. I was supposed to give you this.
Oh, shit!
Something, and then put it in the water. Would you speak more to? Say it, man, to the law.